That's immediately I'm like, oh, they hating on the big girls. I said every curse word. I was distraught.
Missy had been blindsided by the music industry's cynical standards of beauty, but she took comfort in some sound advice from a new friend, queen of hip-hop soul, Mary J. Blige.
When we first met Mary J. Blige, she pulled me to the side and she said, don't worry about your size or anything. You're going to be a star. Hold your head up. That always stuck with me.
I was like, you are extremely talented and everything that's trying to pull you back, you're going to surpass it. When I saw Missy Elliott, I saw nothing but a star.
But Missy's next opportunity wouldn't come so easy, as the basement's creative atmosphere was becoming increasingly claustrophobic.
Devante was very controlling, wanted to know everyone's move, who you were talking to, why you were talking to them, what was the conversation about.
It was almost like we felt mentally abused.
In the fall of 95, the friction within the basement grew progressively worse, until finally things boiled over. After a dispute with his artists over a contract issue, Devante called an urgent meeting, and the scene reportedly turned physical.
When he came in the room, he was throwing chairs. Me and Missy almost got hit in our head with a chair because it was thrown over our head. His bodyguards went down the row and, like, really smacked all the guys and, like, kind of dared them to hit him back. It wasn't nothing that we did to deserve that. None of us. A dog didn't deserve what went on in that room that day.
For Missy, the scene was all too familiar.
I went through watching my father do this with my mother. I remember telling Timberland that I'm gonna leave and I'm never coming back.
The next day, Missy walked away from the basement, leaving behind her group, her deal with Devante, and 3 years of blood, sweat, and beats.
Missy came home. Her dreams are shattered.
It was such a trying time in my life. It's like starting all over again. It's back to square one.
After a few months of soul searching, Missy pulled it together and moved to New York City with a new focus.
I said, you know, I want to just be a writer and I want to produce. I don't want to be an artist. Maybe I don't have the look and I don't have to worry about being judged.
It didn't take long for Missy to land her next big opportunity. Atlantic Records hired Missy and Timbaland to write and produce an album for budding R&B sensation Aaliyah. And from the moment they met, a lasting friendship was born.
You're thinking diva, and she's come in like, why is the heat down and giving me my tea? But here's this young girl, she's smiling and she give us hugs. It made us feel so comfortable.
It really just took a life of its own, the three of them creating.
Me, her, and Tim were inseparable.
While Missy was easing into a career working behind the scenes, everything would change after a chance encounter with Sean Puffy Combs.
Puffy met me through Devante. He remembered that I rapped. So when he seen me in the studio, he came in and he like, yo, Money, don't you still rap? And I'm like, you know, halfway scared to say, yeah. He say, yo, come over here. I want you to listen to this track. I want you to get on this track. So he played the Gina Thompson record. I was like, oh my goodness, this is my chance. So, you know, he left me alone. I wrote the rap, and I was so nervous. But I got in there and rapped like it was my last time ever being able to rap.
Ready for Puff Daddy, beware. How dare he make the remix so deadly? His style, Goomba be my pal like Shazam.
I don't know where the hell how it came from, but it worked. As soon as I said, he was like, oh, like, Puffy, he liked that line.
The Things You Do hit the air in July of 96. The song was an instant hit, and thanks to her signature rap, Missy was back in the game.
And the DJs were freaking out. They were going, did you hear that? He-he-he-he-how. They were like, who is that?
1 month later, Aaliyah's album, One in a Million, was released to rave reviews.
The sound of the beats, the sound of the production, the writing, everything had its own unique flavor and was a dramatic contrast to what was on the radio at the time.
Lightning had struck twice, and overnight, Missy was hip-hop's new it girl.
Everybody wanted to be attached to the hottest new artist. And I was ready to be in business with her no matter what it took.
Sylvia Rhone, CEO of Elektra Records, signed Missy to an unprecedented deal that included having her own label where she could work with other artists. But there was one condition. First, Missy had to make an album of her own.
Sylvia, she really saw something in me. And she like, just be you and let's make a hot record.
Missy jumped right into the studio with Timbaland. Just 2 weeks later, they had created the tracks that would change the face of hip-hop.
Me, I'm super fly, super duper fly, super duper.
Coming up, Missy turns the hip-hop world on its ear.
I wanted to just break down all barriers and be a risk taker.
I'm bald right now, so it's obvious I'm going a little bit extra daring. She's a bitch.
And later, she's stricken by a mysterious illness.
I was eating, but I was just losing weight and losing weight. I had been feeling sick. The mood swings was up and down, up and down.
It was really, really rough for her because she didn't know what was wrong. That was all kind of a very scary time for her.
When Behind the Music continues. In the summer of 1997, after signing a lucrative deal with Elektra Records, Missy Elliott turned the hip-hop world on its head. When she dropped her debut album, Supa Dupa Fly.
I thought I had something that was unique. I wanted to break down all barriers, and I wanted to be a risk taker. Ooh, I stop it swimming like you want
to. I can take it like a pro. Missy came and did something that made us like, I thought Supa Dupa Fly was super duper innovative and amazing.
Timbaland's drum sounds, his patterns, Missy's style of rapping, the way she kind of incorporated all these different sounds, everything about it was different.
Supa Dupa Fly shot to number 3 on the Billboard charts, the highest debut for any female rapper in history. But it was the Hype Williams-directed music video for Missy's first single, The Rain, that truly changed the game.
Super fly, super duper fly, super duper fly.
It was part cartoon, it was hip-hop, it was science fiction, it was the Jetsons, it was just beyond.
The rain hits my window, I take it, me some info, me and Timberland, we sang a jangle.
In an era where female rappers were expected to emulate the raunchy look of Lil' Kim and Foxy Brown, Missy, who had never forgotten being left out of Raven Simone's video, created The Rain, a defiant response to an industry where image is everything.
She was saying, me, I'm super fly, super duper fly, super duper fly. She really felt so fly.
We came up with this idea of being in a big plastic garbage bag, basically. I said, I'm gonna show them. I'm gonna make a record and it's gonna be big. And I'm gonna be big too, and I mean literally. I'm gonna stay my size and have a big record. And that's that.
Overnight, Missy had changed the game for women in hip hop by making it big while staying true to herself.
I'm up there with Foxy Brown, Lil' Kim, and Lauryn Hill. I'm like, okay, I can get used to this. This is cool. You thought just the cute skinny girls was on the cover, so it's like, okay, big girls rock.
She could be 300 pounds right now. We wouldn't care, because we didn't love Missy for her weight. We loved Missy because she was doing something different and innovative.
On the heels of Supa Dupa Fly, Missy had also become one of the most sought-after producers in hip-hop, and in 1 month got 3 remarkable offers.
I remember I got a call from Mariah Carey. She like, I want to work with you. I'm going to fly to Virginia. I'm like,
Now, why are these people playing on my phone? Then I got a call from Whitney Houston. When she called, of course, I didn't believe it. And I made her sing. And she started singing. I was like, oh, no, that's Whitney. I wanted to scream. Then here go Janet Jackson. And if I can recall, I think I hung up on her because I didn't believe it was Janet Jackson. It's crazy. All in 1 month. Yeah, I was in heaven.
Just 26 years old, Missy was on top of the world and was also a millionaire. As a child, she dreamed of rescuing her mother. Now she made good on her promise.
I said, you know, I'm going to get my mother a big old house. She went through so much. She's so deserving of it.
I was like, wow, we're Oprah. I was like, this is big money. Oh, my God, we're jumping around. We were like the Jeffersons.
Being able to do for your mother is everything.
In 1999, Missy released her sophomore effort, The Real World.
She's a bitch when I do my thing. Got the place on fire, burn it down the flame.
The video for She's a Bitch pushed the envelope once again, cementing Missy's cutting-edge credibility.
What you say, huh? The video, I really think this is going to top the rain because we just going, you know, I'm bald right now. So it's obvious I'm going a little bit extra than the rain. And I got a couple of more other scenes that's a little bit daring.
She's a bitch. See, I got more cheese. So back on up.
Once the video was shot, I was like, 5 years from now, people will look at this and be like, they was ahead of their time in so many ways.
The Real World would go on to sell over 1 million records. And after two smash albums, Missy appeared to have it all. But privately, she was still haunted by the demons of her past. The sexual abuse she suffered as a child was a painful secret she could no longer keep to herself.
I felt like I had to be a teacher. I wanted people